Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Hard Truth by Nevada Barr, narrated by Barbara Rosenblat and directed by Greta Byram. This book is copyrighted 2005 by Nevada Barr. This recording is copyrighted 2005 by Recorded Books. Just 3 days after her wedding to Sheriff Paul Davidson, Anna Pigeon moves from Mississippi to Colorado to assume her new post as district ranger at Rocky Mountain National Park. But when two young girls, who had been missing for a month, reappeared traumatized but claiming to remember nothing of their ordeal, Anna determines to get to the truth of the matter. And now, Hard Truth.
Chapter 1. Jiminy Christmas! Heath resisted the call of stronger language out of respect for her aunt's southern sensibilities. Cross them or fold them or something. Don't just leave them laying there like a couple of dead carp. Heath looked away from her legs. Though they were tidily covered in denim trousers, and, to all intents and purposes, looked like the legs of any seated, trim, 41-year-old woman, she couldn't bear the sight of them. "How about I pretzel them?" Gwen said, turning from the campground's especially designed picnic table, where she was setting out a plate on the specially designed end so Heath's specially designed wheelchair would roll under oh so specially. "Why don't you get Wiley to do it? He's a highly trained helper." Heath looked to where the dog lay under the table, watching a Mama Mallard and her three late-season ducklings with an evil glint in his eyes. He was originally named Prince Theo III, but she and her aunt called him Wiley because of an uncanny resemblance he bore to the cartoon coyote after a run-in with roadrunners and sticks of TNT. "Wiley's off duty. Wiley's always off duty." Heath leaned over, her belly pressed against the wheelchair's safety belt, an indignity the doctors had promised she could forego when she got used to her altered circumstances and quit pitching face forward every time she leaned too far. With hands as angry and curved as talons, she grabbed her right ankle and jerked upward. She could feel the leg in her hands, but not her hands on her leg. It reminded her of a creepy childhood trick. Her best friend Sylvia would hold her palm to hers, then, feeling the backs of the fingers, one her own, one Heath's, she'd intone, "This is what dead people feel like." And the two of them would squeal in horrific delight. "This is what dead people feel like," Heath said. Gwen ignored her. Wiley watched the baby ducks picking at crumbs with a fluff of ducky butts and murmurs of ducky glee. Heath set her ankle on the opposite knee, like stacking firewood, and wondered if she'd cut off her circulation or done any other damage to her insensate lower half. At least the plastic tubes were gone. The modern-day Frankensteins who had reworked her lower half had cheerfully told her that regaining control of her bowels and bladder was a positive sign. She tried to be grateful for this small shred of autonomy and dignity left to her. For a couple months after the fall, she'd played Christopher Reeve, pretending to be as optimistic, as cheerful, but she was a lousy actor. And when the doctors told her, with a crushed third lumbar vertebra, she had the chance of the proverbial snowball in hell of climbing again, she'd rung down the curtain, the first of many curtains. Little light now came into her spiritual house. "Shit," she said, for no other reason than it seemed to express the gestalt of the moment. Gwen turned, leaned on the prosthetically elongated end of the picnic table. Gwendolyn Littleton was Heath's aunt. She was 71, thin and in superb condition. Her hair was eternally and determinedly red. She swore she would go to the grave, clutching a bottle of Lady Clairol in one hand and a bottle of hormone replacement pills in the other. She wore her naturally frizzy hair up in a wild bird's nest she referred to as a Neo Gibson girl. Her face wasn't youthful or even pretty, but Heath loved it. Every wrinkle turned up at the end, forcing against gravity and life's myriad evils by Gwen's tendency to laugh at that which did not kill. She wasn't laughing now. The hurt Heath had caused showed around Gwen's mouth and eyes, a flinching as if from a physical blow. Maybe a camping trip was a rotten idea. Not camping. Handy camping, Heath retorted, and was sorry when the pinch of pain on her aunt's face deepened. Gotta call it something, sugar, Gwen said gently, her southern drawl making sugar the sweetest of words. Heath said nothing. Shame clogged her throat. Shame and self-pity, and shame at the self-pity. Hey, Wiley, she called the dog. He heaved himself to his paws with a gusty sigh and ambled over in his loose-jointed way. It had been said that every cloud had a silver lining. For Heath, this bedraggled, smart, ugly dog was it. The one thin flicker in the great dark firmament, like low summer lightning beneath a Midwestern tornado sky. Hey, dog, she said, and scratched his ratty ears. On December 23rd, Heath had fallen from an ice chute up by the keyhole on Long's Peak. Rotten ice had dropped her 68 feet to a helicopter ride and her new life as a cripple. 68 feet. Lucky to be alive, everyone said. The hospital had been her world through March. Physical therapy, Prozac, more physical therapy, Effexor, pool therapy, Xanax. Lots of Xanax. Watching people in gaily colored scrubs prattling in gaily banal conversation, manipulating chunks of flesh and bone she could no longer feel, gave Heath the creeps. On the Ides of March, she'd given up. Quit. The antidepressants she'd flushed down the john. She wasn't depressed because her brain didn't work. She was depressed because her life no longer worked. The wheelchair came in April, Wiley in June. The dog and Gwen kept Heath from folding like a cheap kite in a windstorm. Lucky to be alive, Heath said, to see if it sounded true yet. It didn't. Lucky for me, Gwen replied. And again, Heath felt guilty. The late summer day had eased seamlessly into night. Stars appeared and disappeared as the last of the monsoons, the northern edge of them, visited Rocky, and thundercells racketed around the mountains. Lightning flickered over Long's Peak and Flattop. Thunder rolled down the canyons from the high places, bringing the ineffable perfume of rain on pines, an elixir that made even Heath feel alive. The feeling was followed immediately by the memory of a life. "What is it, darling?" Gwen asked, as she tidied away the ends of their meal, whisking the crumbs from the hot dog buns onto the ground for the ducklings. "You're feeding the wildlife," Heath accused to avoid the question. "The crumbs just fell off." Gwen sat on the picnic table, feet on the bench. "You look so down. Mountain air is supposed to lift the spirits, make the heart sing." "Yeah," Heath agreed. Then the wine said, "It might work if I wasn't a fucking cripple." She smiled because Gwen wanted her to, but she could feel the riptide of alcohol and despair dragging her down to the cold, dark bottom of the sea, where one day she could drown in booze or bitterness. She tried to think of heroes, of Lance Armstrong, of the man who cut his arm off with a pocket knife rather than die in the wilderness, of those people who'd overcome and triumphed. But they could walk. An arm was nothing, a few toes, a foot, even one leg. From where she sat, those looked like a cakewalk. They, the lucky, the one-armed, the one-legged, the three-toed, were not helpless. It was the helplessness as much as the loss of her old life, her old self, that scared Heath witless. Scared her so bad she'd told no one, not even Gwen. Bears could eat her, fires burn her, criminals mug her, little boys torment her, and there was nothing she could do about it but rail pathetically or die. "Stop it," she said. "What?" Gwen, roused from contemplation of an ember in the barbecue grate, a poor understudy for a campfire, but all that was allowed in the park during fire season. "Wiley was licking my hand," Heath lied. Gwen looked at the relatively innocent dog lying some yards from the wheelchair, but said nothing. I'm for bed. Not to sleep, to read, she assured her niece, and Heath wondered if the stab of fear she'd felt at being left alone had shown on her face. I'm going for a walk, a roll, Heath announced, to prove fear wasn't what Gwen had seen. The older woman stopped, one foot in the tent, one out, the rein fly in her hand. Heath waited to be told not to go, or for Gwen to pretend she wanted to come along. After too long a silence, Gwen said, "Don't run over anybody," and ducked out of sight into the orange toadstool she was calling home for 3 nights. Heath would sleep in the back of the RV. It had been fitted out for her special needs. "Fucking Special Olympian," she muttered to herself, and unlocked the brakes on her chair, so Gwen would hear her rolling away and know she wasn't bluffing about the walk. Though she could afford a mechanized chair, she'd opted for the hand-powered variety. Rolling her own weight around was a small thing, but it mattered. Not much, but she had fallen from the realm of choosers into the realm of beggars, and she clung to it. The paths, Heath was enough of a snob, she couldn't bring herself to call them trails, throughout the Sprague Lake handicamp were wide and graveled. Like the picnic tables and toilets, they were designed to accommodate people with disabilities. The one she chose headed toward the lake, an exquisite shallow jewel of water, dammed in the early part of the 20th century to form a fishing lake for a lodge, long since dismantled. Having rolled a few yards, Heath stopped. The crunching of wheels on crushed rock should have convinced Gwen she'd really gone, and Gwen would be listening, worrying, waiting. Knowledge of this protective love grated on Heath's nerves. To be helpless was either to be alone or without privacy. The former was terrifying, the latter intolerable. With a determined push, she sent herself not on the level boardwalk spanning a lobe of the lake, but up the steep path that wound into a forest of lodgepole and ponderosa. A grade she once wouldn't have deigned to call a bunny slope now taxed her back and shoulder muscles. The vertebra she'd smashed was low enough she still had some motor control in her hips and butt. The doctors said that made her stronger. Stronger than what? She sweated and puffed. Effort filled the mind. Fear was not gone, only pushed back, just out of sight. It followed her, chasing her into the thicker darkness beneath the evergreens. Heath drove blind, but she didn't slow down. Knuckles brushed fur. Wiley had come unbidden. The dog stayed close, but he wasn't a seeing eye dog. Her right wheel crashed into a branch or rock. The chair twisted, throwing Heath to one side. A flash of old wisdom spun through her mind. Steer into the skid. But this wasn't ice. It was gravity. And she went down. 3 seconds in darkness, and not so free fall, took a long time and ended abruptly. Her elbow struck something soft. She had the decency to hope it wasn't Wiley. Above ear level, she could hear the spinning of a wheel. Only a few months had passed since she'd taken this seat that was to be hers for life, yet already she knew the wheelchair like liars claimed to know the backs of their hands. Each click and slip and groan spoke to her. By the clean whir of the hub, she knew the wheel hadn't been damaged. For half a minute, she gave in to the rattle and hum of wheel and brainwaves sloshing against her reoriented skull. When her thoughts cleared, she took stock. Nothing hurt. But then half of her could be gashed and bleeding, and in the dark, she'd never know it. "The hell with you, then," she muttered to her legs, and focused on that which was still sensate. The arm of the chair beneath her dug into her side. She could feel with the belt pulled across her abdomen. Because of the crazy cold wiring of nerves and sensations she retained, the medical wizards assured her she had the capacity to enjoy a fairly normal sex life, whatever that was. As a consolation prize, sex didn't cut it. Asked to choose between sex and a 5'13 pitch, Heath would have climbed. For a while, she lay still. The wheel spun. Mosquitoes whined in her ear. Strong in her nostrils, the smell of dirt and loam comforted her. Wiley licked her hands and face. lying alone in the dark, a wreck of bone and metal, suited her. Till she heard the snuffling. Then the fear she'd been running from caught up to her. Even fear had changed. When she was a real person, a whole person, herself, fear tingled and burned through her veins like lightning, electrifying brain and muscle, till she felt as if she could think her way through solid stone, outrun jaguars. Now it was a sick, cold thing that spread like poison, shutting her down, reeking out through her pores in a chill sweat. A woof. A piggy grunt. Bear. There were no grizzly bears in Rocky. But for the most part, grizzlies weren't interested in eating people. They wanted to scare them away. Black bears, usually shy when they came to dine. A year before, a black bear had bitten into the skulls of two young men up at Fern Lake. They'd been sleeping in their tents. Surely even sleeping, two young men were more formidable than one middle-aged paraplegic strapped to an overturned chair. Sprague Lake Handy Camp would be just the place for a hungry bear. Human snacks arranged on metal and plastic trays. The Park Service should have named the place Cantina de los Osos. Heath snorted at the thought, and the snuffling came again. Louder, closer this time. Wiley began to growl, low in his throat, the kind of growl that raised his hackles and hers. Primal in its intensity, fear ran through Heath like black ice. Even the quiescent flesh of her lower body seemed to thrum with it. Every cell demanded flight, and for one brief second, she believed she would rise up from the dirt and run from the woods. The adrenaline rush jerked her shoulders, but her legs remained dead weight. Wiley left her side, no longer growling, but rumbling deep in his chest. The bear would kill him, snap his scrawny neck with one swipe. The loss of the mangy-looking dog was more than Heath could stand. A modicum of courage returned. She could move. Fumbling at her waist, she undid the safety belt with more luck than dexterity. The weight of her legs pulled her over onto the dirt. She could feel it under both hands, beneath her chin. "Wiley," she said. "Come here, boy. Now. Come. Now." Though she'd meant to shout, pushed with lungs and diaphragm, her voice was a tiny thread of air, like screams in a nightmare. The chair had saddlebags filled with the necessary things of life, magazines, dog biscuits, cigarettes, and, because she was roughing it in the special wilderness, a flashlight. Maybe light would frighten away the bear. Maybe it would only let her see who was coming to dinner. However humble, a goal gave her strength. She wriggled and pawed at the leather flap. The ends of her fingers felt numb. For one horrible moment, she thought her crash had broken another vertebra, one higher in her back, and the swelling was robbing her of sensation in the half-body that remained to her. The buckle gave way, and the contents of the pouch fell out, striking wrists and dirt. Fingers scrabbled. The barrel of the flashlight came under her hand, and she grabbed it. Wiley's rumble escalated to a high-pitched whine that penetrated the enamel of Heath's teeth and made her skull reverberate. Dragging her weight on her elbows, legs trailing behind, she crawled toward the dog. "Quiet, Wiley. Come here." The hand, without the flashlight, struck something furry. Hoping it was part of Wiley and not the bear, she closed her fingers around a bony ankle. Wiley let out a bark that ripped the darkness. Still holding onto the dog, she thumbed the flashlight on. She held it backward, and the light blasted her retinas. Startled, she dropped it, found it, pointed it in the right direction. "Holy shit," she whispered. Then the screaming began. Chapter 2. Anna looked at her left hand for the umpteenth time. The band of gold on her ring finger was so new it was mirror bright from jeweler's polish, and there was hardly a scratch on it. The band was plain, no twining leaves, no gems, no patterned etching, no words were engraved inside. When Paul had brought her the rings to ask if they might be used, he told her their story. In 1945, after being mustered out of the army, his father bought them from a jewelry store in New York City, then brought them back to Natchez in hopes he would one day wed. 4 years later, he'd met the woman who would be Paul's mother, and they'd set the date. When the day came, Paul's father went to the chest in his bedroom where they'd been kept. A hole was gnawed through the corner of the chest, and the back of the cardboard box that had contained the rings was eaten away. Inside the box, where the rings had waited so long, were two dried-up acorns. On the way to the church, the groom picked up two tin rings at the five and dime. A year later, on their first anniversary, he'd replaced them with gold. In 1952, with the first child due, Mrs. Davidson was sewing a tiny layette while Mr. Davidson knocked out the back wall of the bedroom to build a nursery onto the house. Amid the debris and dirt from the wall of the 93-year-old house was the detritus of a long-dead pack rat's nest. Pride of place among the screws and bolts and hairpins were the wedding rings. It had been decided that they would be set aside for the baby to bring to his or her mate for their wedding. Paul's first wife wanted diamonds. Knowing that, he had never shown her the rings or told her the story. "Our union was prophesied by a rat," Anna had said, but she loved the rat, the ring, the man, and the tale. She even loved the former Mrs. Paul Davidson for being too greedy to want the gold and too ambitious to keep the man. From the wooden balcony of her honeymoon cabin, Anna watched the rat's gold catch the candlelight. The cabin was of logs, new and neatly fit together, red-brown with polyurethane finish. The balcony was on the second floor, with French doors that led into a pleasant bedroom. From where she sat, she could see the mountains of Colorado, sparked tonight by lightning, and smell the sweetness of pine. The place was ideal, the ring ideal, if Anna'd only had a husband to share it with. The honeymoon would have been close to perfect. She stared at the cell phone Paul had given her, a phone with free long distance and more minutes than it had taken the Hebrew God to create the world. Cell phones were annoying. They were too small, made odd noises, cut in and out. Mostly Anna hated them because they were by nature intrusive. They broadcast civilization's blather and fuss into places it was never meant to be. Their shrill insistence and one-sided shout sullied the myriad blessings of the out-of-doors. Despite this antithetical relationship, she considered using it, calling Paul just to tell him how sweet the air, how bright the stars. It was an hour later in Port Gibson, Mississippi, than it was in Estes Park, Colorado. Nearly 11 o'clock. Paul would probably have been in bed for an hour. He wouldn't mind her waking him. Not on their honeymoon. What self-respecting bridegroom would? As she reached for the phone, the radio in the bedroom demanded her attention. 201 Romo, 201 Romo. Romo, Rocky Mountain, the park's designating letters. Anna had never worked anywhere dispatch went by a name. She thought it rather endearing, and she welcomed the interruption. Ruining some visitor's evening was preferable to staring at the phone. This is 201. There was a momentary pause. Anna was not the first woman ever to be district ranger in Rocky Mountain National Park, but had only been the Thompson River district ranger for 2 days. Romo was not yet accustomed to hearing her voice. She grabbed notebook and pen. Go ahead, Romo. The night dispatcher was a seasonal employee, but she'd been with the park for 7 seasons and knew her business. She laid out what facts were known in a voice better suited to soothing crying infants than spelling out law enforcement horrors. Anna loved it. There was no situation that couldn't be improved with a little maternal calm. We've had a garbled report from a gas station owner just outside the park. An RV pulled in several minutes ago, requesting an ambulance at Sprague Lake Handy Camp. The RV driver was agitated. Apparently, he tried a call from Sprague, but couldn't get a signal. Any indication of who was injured? 2 women, evidently. I got all this from the gas station attendant. The RV man drove off before giving any other information. An ambulance has been dispatched. Where's 202? Anna gave the number of the law enforcement ranger who was on duty in the front country from 4 till midnight, when the park's problem calls were turned over to the local sheriff's department. Tied up with an elk Toyota collision by Bear Lake. I should be at Sprague in 10 to 15 minutes, Anna said, and broke contact. The cabin she rented from the NPS was on the outskirts of the park across from the visitor's center. She was so new to the place, she had yet to unpack, and cardboard boxes took the place of furnishings. Most of her things hadn't been moved, only as much as could be loaded into a small U-Haul in a hurry. This proof of the unsettled nature of her life was sufficiently depressing. She was grateful when she could leave it. Out alone at night, the dark mountains around her, moraine meadow rolling out gray and silver to the west, the scent of rain and pine and dust gentle on the air blowing in through the car's window. Anna was reassured she'd made the right decision in leaving Mississippi, leaving Paul. District Ranger in Rocky Mountain was a pay grade higher on the government service scale, and the park itself considerably up the food chain as far as glamour, adventure, and political clout went, than her old duty station, the Natchez Trace Parkway. It was an opportunity that wouldn't knock often. The plum had only fallen to Anna by way of a series of fortuitous events. Lorraine Knight, the chief ranger at Yosemite, with whom Anna had worked in the past, had taken the deputy superintendent's position at Rocky. When one of her district rangers, a 35-year veteran of the NPS, had retired, Lorraine contacted Anna and helped shepherd her application through the inevitable jungles of red tape at the regional personnel office. 2 days before they were to be married, Anna and her husband-to-be, Paul Davidson, sat down to discuss the job offer. Paul had recently been re-elected sheriff of Claiborne County. Anna had been offered the position of a lifetime 1,300 miles west. They loved their jobs. They loved one another. But they'd been at their jobs many more years than they'd been sweethearts. 1 year, they'd decided, for one calendar year, they would carry on a long-distance marriage. At the end of that year, one would give up a job and make a home in the other's shadow. Or they wouldn't. The wouldn't was unspoken, but Anna, if not Paul, heard it loud and clear. 3 days after the wedding, she moved to Rocky. Customarily, the NPS wasn't so heartless, but Rocky had been too much in the news that summer. The park needed normalcy. The rangers, particularly in Thompson River District, needed reassurance, routine, even more so than most corporate cultures. That of a national park was vulnerable to epidemics of mass insanity. Perhaps because of the isolation and the high adrenaline aspects, park personnel bonded quickly and tightly. When something disrupted those bonds, the reverberations could shudder on for years. Anna had seen litigious employees divide a park. In the case of Rocky, it had been the search for missing children. For 4 weeks, Romo searched. The children were never found. After the search was discontinued, the Thompson River District Ranger retired. The rangers involved intimately with the search had been left with the weight of 3 lifetimes of unfinished business to carry on their shoulders. At the edge of Moraine Meadow, just before the ragged black line of trees swallowed the road, 2 coyotes trotted across in front of Anna's car. Though western Colorado suffered a drought, the glacier-carved meadow was rich with grass. Mice, pikas, squirrels, and other small denizens raised big broods on the wealth of forage. As a consequence, these Rocky Mountain coyotes were fat, their fur thick and glossy in the moonlight. The two of them could have understudied for Rin and Mrs. Tintin. Where Anna had grown up, on the edge of Smoke Creek Desert, the coyotes looked like starving, mangy hounds. It was good to see at least some of the park's critters looking so prosperous. Balance was impossible to maintain when the depredations of man smashed so many links from the food chain. The bigger carnivores, grizzlies, wolves, and ever increasingly mountain lions, had been killed off. Coyotes weren't fearsome enough to thin the herds of elk. Once in a while, they'd get a newborn or the old and sickly, but not often enough. The elk were rapidly eating themselves into a food shortage that would bring on starvation and its attendant diseases. Assuredly, this would thin the herds, but it wasn't the sort of spectacle John Q. Public liked to bring the kiddies camping to see. In Yellowstone National Park in Wyoming, wolves had been successfully reintroduced. So successfully, occasionally a wolf was seen outside the park. Not a month before, a rancher up near Jackson had shot a nursing female. Resource managers from Yellowstone searched, but she'd hidden her den too well, and her pups weren't found. Colorado used this and other wolf-as-evil-predator stories to justify the state resolution that these four-legged livestock-eating varmints would never be brought back to Rocky. Wyoming's wolves were only one day's long walk north. There were those hoping a few would take it into their heads to cross state lines. If the wolves came on their own, they'd fall under the protection of the Endangered Species Act. The black shadows of the trees took the coyotes. Then Anna's patrol car. She caught up with the park's ambulance at the Big Thompson River Bridge and trailed it to Sprague Lake Handy Camp. The ambulance ran dark. At this hour, with little or no traffic to hinder it, the rangers had rightly chosen not to break the peace of the park and run with lights and siren. Sprague Camp's toilets were on a center island in the middle of a large parking lot with spaces radiating out like spokes. The rim of this ovate wheel was where the sites were located, all of them with easy access by graveled path to the asphalt. The ambulance and Anna circled the lot slowly. There was none of the light and babble of a hair-raising event to clue them in to which campers had placed the call. When they'd completed half the circle, the ambulance's headlights cut an angular woman from the surrounding night. She had wild red hair, was clad in a blue sweatshirt and khaki shorts, and was waving them to the curb. She introduced herself as Dr. Gwen Littleton, OBGYN, retired. Anna's favorite sort of emergency hostess, she was calm, sensible, and informative. The only aspect of her demeanor that suggested all was not well was the blood smeared down the front of her shorts. Chapter 3. "No, no," Heath was crying, but the screaming wouldn't stop. Her mind jumped to its feet and ran to them. The need and the response to it were so great, it startled her to find she still lay on the ground, less ambulatory than a beached whale. With sudden inspiration, she turned the light back on herself. "See," she said, "a lady, just a crippled lady. See my chair? I crashed. I can't hurt you. Look." She shone the light down at her legs. "I can't walk. You're okay. Hush now. Hush." They couldn't have been more than 12 years old. Both were thin to the point bones stuck out at pelvis and collarbone. Heath could see this because they wore nothing but filthy underwear. One had on panties that once had been pink and a matching camisole, ripped at one shoulder, exposing a breast so scratched and muddied. At first, Heath hadn't differentiated fabric from skin. The other girl wore white cotton panties and a bra, intact but filthy. Mud, feces, blood, Heath couldn't tell. From the smell, it was probably all three. They had nothing else on. No shoes, no socks, no water, nothing. Scratches, cuts and bruises discolored their legs and feet. "It's over now. I'm here. You're okay." "I'm here. Jesus." Helplessness washed over Heath till she was nauseated with it. There wasn't a damn thing she could do, not even yell for Gwen. The girls had quieted to whimpers, the low, pitiful kind that puppies make when they have nightmares. But they looked ready to bolt back into the woods if she made any loud noises. That couldn't happen. Heath couldn't carry that around with her. Not in a fucking wheelchair. "Could you please help me?" she said finally, her voice as soft and kind as if she lured bunnies from their burrow. "See, I'm paralyzed, and my chair fell over, and I can't get myself up." In all the months since the accident, Heath had never once asked for help. Now that she did, she felt as if she were lying. The fact that it was true and that she asked it of two little girls who couldn't even help themselves struck her as horrifically funny, and she laughed. The sound struck the girls like a blow, and they skittered, ready to run. "Oh, my God, please!" Heath cried. Terrified, they'd run back into whatever hell they'd just found their way out of. "I'm hurt. Please help me. I'm hurting." This last was a lie. Not only was there no feeling in half of Heath's body, but there was enough adrenaline in her veins, she doubted she'd have felt pain even if she'd crashed in a nest of yellow jackets. The girl stopped. One of them, the one with the bared breast, took a step closer. "I'm all tangled up, see?" Again, Heath shone the flashlight on her legs and the overturned wheelchair. "We thought you were a bear," the girl said, in a voice years too young for the body it emanated from, the voice of a 3-year-old. "I thought you guys were bears," Heath told her. "I got scared and tried to get back to camp, but my wheelchair fell over." "Heath? Heath!" A sharp-edged cry came through the darkness. Before the girls could run, Heath hurried on. "That's my aunt. She's an old lady." Mentally, she apologized to Gwen for the characterization. "She can't lift me by herself, but she's real nice. She made s'mores for dessert. They're real good. There's some left." Heath realized she was talking as if she spoke to preschoolers, toddlers, not young girls. But these battered children had slipped back in time and mind, and treating them like babies felt right. "Heath, damn it, answer me!" Thunder sounded in the distance, underlining Gwen's shout. "Will you stay and help my aunt put me back together again?" Heath pleaded. "Humpty Dumpty," said the one who'd not yet spoken, and she giggled, a high, uneven sound with the broken notes of hysteria beneath. "Just like Humpty Dumpty," Heath said and smiled. "Okay, I'm going to holler for my aunt. Don't be scared. She's a nice person and a doctor. A lady doctor. Ready?" "Up here," Heath yelled. "Up the trail on the eastern side of the tent. Bring a light." "Heath!" Gwen cried again, and there was the sound of feet pounding up the trail. A "youch!" and a "damn it!" And Gwen stumbled up to the overturned chair. "Are you all right? My God, I heard screaming. Gwen," Heath stopped her with a concrete tone. "I want you to meet some friends of mine." Heath shined her light on her aunt's face to show the girls Gwen was truly, if not as she represented her, at least a kindly soul who did not apparently devour lost children. "My aunt." Introduction made, she turned her light on the girls still in the woods, still poised as if for flight, or a blow. Gwen's light followed in natural succession, and the children cowered. "Oh, my heavens! My heavens, my darlings, poor babies. Y'all come here. Whatever happened? No, never you mind that. Whatever it is, it's over. Come on, sweethearts. Oh, look at your little feet." Gwen started toward them, propelled by a maternal instinct that had inspired her to deliver thousands of babies and take care of their sniffles, mumps, and other disasters, large and small, till they reached young adulthood. The girls were mesmerized by the soft southern flow of motherly love, but didn't leave their woodland darkness till Heath remembered Wiley. Or rather, Wiley intruded into her world again by pushing his nose under her arm. Good sense or good training had stopped his aggression the moment Heath had identified the girls as non-threatening. Something, probably the arrival of Gwen, a witness to his dereliction, made him decide it was time to come back on duty. "Bring them to me," Heath said to the dog, and pointed at the shivering, half-naked creatures. Obligingly, Wiley trotted into the circle of illumination made by the two flashlights. The dog Gwen had bought, in hopes of increasing Heath's so-called independence, might not have won a single show or even placed. He wasn't the best or smartest helper. What Wiley had was wit and charm. His walk was the jaunty distillation of cartoon cocksuredness, and his scruffy demeanor an example of nature mirroring art, Crooked whiskers, half-salute ears, baleful grin, raggedy fur. His maker had fashioned a Disney star. Only fate had decided he had a higher calling.
Ooh,
the girls cooed, like a movie audience when baby tigers gambol onto the screen.
A dog.
Wiley sat down neatly in front of them and cocked his head as if in approval of their astute zoological perception. That pose complete, he bowed down, front legs outstretched, chin on paws. He's a ham, Heath said, half apologetically from her bed of dirt and rock. Now that the excitement was over and Wiley had successfully taken the intruders captive, her elbows were registering complaints about supporting her body so long. The children followed Wiley out the 3 or 4 yards from forest to path. They were in sorry shape. How sorry, Heath guessed, from the sharp intake of breath, full view of them elicited from her aunt.
Go ahead back to camp, Heath said. I can get myself righted.
No, I can't.
Gwen looked from Heath to the girls and back. The look of panic on her face as she struggled with the minuscule Sophie's choice, whether to leave her crippled niece sprawled helpless in the dirt, or to get the children to safety and warmth before they bolted or collapsed, infuriated Heath.
I can do it,
she hissed, hating herself because maybe she couldn't, and hating Gwen because maybe she knew it, and hating the sound of her voice, peevish and beseeching at the same time. Gwen hesitated just long enough, Heath wanted to spit at her like an angry cat, or cry. Then, muttering soothing nothings, she gathered the girls to her and started down the path. Heath allowed herself to lay her head down for a moment, cushioned on her folded arms. She was exhausted in mind and body and soul, the kind of tired that gets in the bones, replacing marrow with tears. She couldn't get back in the chair. She doubted she could even set the chair back on its wheels. The fall from the ice hadn't merely taken her legs. It had taken her strength, her endurance, her willingness. Hot, none-too-sweet-smelling breath blew on the back of her neck. Wiley had stayed behind. He knew which side his kibble was buttered on.
What are you looking at?
Heath growled. Wiley did his courtly bow again. Oh, yeah, like that's gonna work on me. But it did. It always did. The machinations required to return her butt to its previous place, 26 inches up, on a scrap of vinyl, took considerably longer than she would have thought. Before she'd even dragged her worthless legs around the right way and got her chair up and the brakes locked, she was drenched in sweat and as filthy as a prolonged bout of wallowing in the dirt could make a woman. With the assistance of the dog, the vocabulary of a stevedore, and a small pine tree, she finally regained her chair. Gwen never came thumping back up the path to see if she was all right. By turns, Heath was grateful for the faith and pissed off at the indifference. When she rolled back into camp, heralded by her wheels crunching obnoxiously on the gravel and her flashlight held in her lap like the headlight of a crotch-high train, Gwen had both girls dressed in sweatsuits, one Gwen's own, the other belonging to Heath. Water was on the camp stove, heating for tea, and Aunt Gwen had returned to her old persona as Dr. Littleton. One of the girls had both her feet in Gwen's lap, allowing the doctor to bathe and dress them. The quietest one, the littlest, sat with her feet soaking in the dishpan. The girls saw Heath, and the tranquil field hospital scene shattered. As one, they cried out, feet went flying, dirty water and blood spattered on Gwen, hissed against the chimney of a lantern. Disregarding injuries and what had to be a lot of pain, the children scrambled free of lawn chair and picnic table. Gwen was calling.
Wait! No, sweetie, your feet. No, darlings, you mustn't.
Wiley, forgetting his training and his trusted position as good disciplined helper, began to bark. A litany of self-scorn poured through Heath's mind, a mind made feeble from fighting gravity and floundering helplessness, rolling in, rocks clattering under her wheels like some sort of deformed robo-beast from a Terminator prequel. She was more monster than human. The girls, already traumatized by God knew what,
and from their state of undress. Heath could hazard a guess, were terrified, running. They ran, not away, but toward her. Heath stopped. The flashlight fell from her lap, rolled a few feet along the ground. They want Wiley, the scruffy charmer, Heath realized. Then the girls were upon her, Wiley ignored, Gwen forgotten. The taller of the two hung about her neck, nearly strangling her. The quiet one crawled into her lap, knees banging the metal of the chair, elbow digging into Heath's middle, and detached herself like a limpet. Both were crying. Not the tiny whimpers of the woods, but bawling like babies, gulping and sobbing. Heath could feel tears hot as embers falling on her neck and cheek. These two battered girls saw her as their savior. Heath felt like a fraud. Wiley had found them. Gwen had rescued them. All Heath had done was writhe on the ground like a half-squashed earthworm. "You poor little buggers," she said softly. "You must have had a real bad rap." Gwen and Wiley shepherding, Heath blew out the last of her strength, pushing her wheels through the crushed rock with her added burden. The smaller girl did not want to leave her lap, and for reasons she wasn't certain of, Heath didn't want to make her. Maybe it was just that whatever had happened to the girl, it was probably ugly. Definitely ugly. Maybe uglier than anything that had ever befallen Heath. Even waking up in a hospital room and being told she'd never walk again. If sitting on a rolling lap, clinging to half a middle-aged ex-climber, comforted her, so be it. And maybe Heath needed a little comforting herself. Gwen coaxed the girls back to their former positions. The lap sitter was finally lured to the bench and allowed her feet to be returned to the dishpan, but chose not to let go of Heath's hand. Wiley took up guard duty while Gwen redressed and bandaged the other child's feet. After the tightly knit darkness beneath the lodgepole pines, the light of Coleman lanterns was shockingly bright. For the first time, Heath was able to see what her dog had sniffed out and her aunt had brought home. The limpet, the darker, smaller girl, who'd flung herself into Heath's lap and still clung so tightly to her hand she wondered if she'd be able to use a knife and fork again, had jaw-length red hair and brown eyes. Shock or night or drugs had dilated her pupils till they looked as black and bottomless as deep wells. Dry wells. There was no glitter of interest or spark of life, though she was probably in sixth or seventh grade. She had the promise of womanly beauty beneath the skin of a baby. Deadly combination. Girls matured earlier every generation, and Heath thought she could smell menstrual blood. In the woods, she noticed both girls' legs were encrusted with grime. How much was blood and how much dirt, she wondered. To cover the grim thoughts, Heath smiled into those empty eyes. The girl who'd spoken first was quite tall. Heath had noticed when she'd walked next to Gwen. Gwen was 5'10", and this slender reed of a girl wasn't much shorter. Judging height was another thing her fall had affected. Sitting down, everyone seemed to tower. Often, Heath felt like an egret among the cows. The tall girl sat in a webbed lawn chair, her feet in Gwen's lap. The child was mostly legs, and what Heath imagined when shampooed was blonde hair, the long, pale, silky kind that most teenagers want and precious few have. Even ratty and caked with grime, the hair hung to the middle of her back. There was something utterly familiar about this girl, and Heath racked her brain, trying to remember if she'd seen her around the park, in the visitor center maybe, or at an eatery in town. Then it came to her. She looked like Skipper, Barbie's little sister, right down to the preternatural long legs and stick-straight hair. Down to the blank, doll-like expression on her face and the unfocused, painted-on eyes. "They aren't talking," she said to her aunt, suddenly realizing the quiet was unnatural. "I know," Gwen said. "Skipper can talk," Heath said. "The girl you've got. She said it's a dog back in the woods." "She doesn't want to talk now, do you, sweetheart?" Gwen said kindly. Heath turned to the red-haired girl with a death grip on her hand. What's your name? The eyes seemed to grow larger, darker, till they resembled what Heath had always imagined interstellar black holes looked like. Places where nothing could survive. Not matter, not rock, not steel. Can I call you Limpet? Heath took the silence for just that. Silence, and stopped prodding. She was afraid she was too heavy-handed, too inept, and would cause more damage. Come here, Wiley. The dog obediently trotted to between Heath's knees and those of the girl. You can hold on to Wiley if you want. I do it when I'm totally freaked out. It always makes me feel better. The limpet looked at the dog and reached out tentatively. Her hand was babyish, dimples where knuckles would one day be, wrists barely defined. Her finger ends were raw and bloody, the black of dirt and old blood, caked under the nails in the tiny creases in the once smooth skin. Go ahead, pet him. He doesn't mind. I think it makes him feel important. The small hand closed in the thick fur of the dog's ruff. Wiley sat very still and grinned. They can understand us at least, Heath said to her aunt. Then, oh, shit, we should call somebody, as she remembered her responsibilities. I've already tried, Gwen said. Skipper's feet were cleaned and bound. The doctor set them gently on the ground and moved over to attend to the limpet's feet. Cell phone won't work in this canyon. The guy camped next to us offered to drive in toward town till he could get a signal and call the rangers. Good. Heath should have thought of that. Since the accident, things had been dropping through the cracks in her brain. Sometimes it felt as if, in losing her legs, her independence, and her mobility, she'd lost part of her mind as well. She'd wondered, but never dared to ask the doctors, for fear they'd add crazy to the list of things wrong with her, if the much-vaunted muscle memory was an actual real thing, bits of knowledge stored, not in the cells of the brain, but cached in cells in other parts of the body. When her brain had lost contact with her legs, had it also lost access to information, memory, and experience, as well as sensation? The sound of a truck engine vibrated out of the trees, and a boxy white ambulance came into view at the far end of the parking lot. Your guy must have got a signal, Heath said. Finish her. Gwen put the limpet's dripping feet in Heath's lap and rose to go flag down the ambulance. Heath's little bears were in bad shape, but of the obvious injuries, those to their feet were the most serious. It was a testimony to their courage and fortitude, or their desperation and terror, that they'd kept on keeping on, putting one bloody, ragged little foot down in front of the other. And it was a testament to their peculiar attachment to her, that they'd leaped up and run to her when she'd wheeled into camp. By the bright yet unilluminating glare of the Coleman lanterns, Heath could still make out the bloody prints their passage left on the crushed gravel. She cupped the battered heels, one in each of the palms of her hands, and looked into the hopeless darkness of the limpet's eyes. Wind gusted through the trees, making the night sigh around them. Hey, sweetie pie, where you been? She whispered. The eyes might have glimmered. Something as tiny as a minnow at the bottom of a deep, night-bound pool seemed to flicker. The limpet's lips parted in an exhaled breath. What have you got for me? Came an alto voice, firm, authoritative, and loud as a sonic boom, in the fragile whisper of contact Heath had managed to establish with the child. A woman, mid-40s or early-50s, under the brim of her flat hat, collar-length hair waved more white than brown, walked into the light. She wore the green and gray of an MPS ranger and carried a gun that was probably standard size, but on her slender hips looked huge and black and in your face. Heath was teetering on disliking her for a number of reasons, starting with her untimely arrival and her doing so on two good legs, when the scales tipped suddenly from casual dislike to overt hostility. Skipper and the limpet began screaming as they'd done when she'd come upon them in the woods. The fragile calm she and Gwen had knit for them shredded. The fragment of light, or life, Heath had seen in the limpet's eyes dove into her internal darkness. The ranger raised both hands as if to show she was harmless and backed away, murmuring, "It's okay. Take it easy. Nobody's gonna hurt you. You're okay." The tone and gesture might have struck Heath as commendable in another person at another time, but the girls had ceased their shrieking and began to cry. Silently, not the snotty, gulping children's sobs they'd drenched her neck with, but the slow, unstoppable tears of old women who knew nothing but despair. Heath had great respect for the instinctive character judgment of dogs and children. True, Wiley was wagging his tail, but this time he'd been outvoted. Chapter 4. "It's okay. You're okay. My name's Anna." Anna had walked into a lot of situations over the years where people weren't all that happy she'd shown up. But she couldn't remember entire parties bursting into tears at the sight of her. The rangers behind her, EMTs who'd brought the ambulance, didn't seem to reassure the children either, though Ryan, a seasonal so cute he actually had an echoing dimple on his left dimple, usually reduced girls of this age to simpering, giggling blobs of hormonal adoration without even trying. The children weren't alone in their antipathy. A disabled woman, 50-ish, and probably fairly good-looking when her face wasn't screwed up preparatory to spitting nails, sat in a wheelchair near the picnic table. It was impossible to tell how tall she was, and briefly, Anna wondered if the question of height became moot when one was relegated to a chair. Petite, probably, she was delicate-boned, her face almost a perfect oval and capped by short, very dark hair in a pixie cut. Cheekbones slashed hard lines below her eyes. Dark brows, straight as a die, ran parallel above them. On a good day, her lips might have softened the effect. Tonight, they were as uncompromising as brows and bones. One of the girls had thrown herself into the woman's lap when Anna had come on the scene. The kid was too big to be a lap baby, and her legs stuck out over the spoked wheels like jersey-clad sticks. Dr. Littleton had run to a tall, skinny child and wrapped an arm protectively about her narrow shoulders. This girl didn't cling, but sat rigid, her hands squeezed tightly between her knees, her chin tucked into her chest. Curtains of filthy, matted blonde hair hung over her face like vines over the mouth of a cave. Doing everything she could think of to make herself small and non-threatening, Anna backed to the edge of the light, squatted on her heels, and removed her Stetson. She raised a hand to keep the EMTs back. Neither girl had anything life-threatening that was readily apparent. What was apparent was that they were suffering severe emotional trauma. Anne wasn't in the mood to exacerbate it any more than she already had. At least the camp dog seemed glad to see her. He was a scruffy excuse for a helpmate, which Anna guessed he was by the vest he wore. A lab shepherd mix, maybe? One that had been washed with dark colors and tumbled in a too-hot dryer. "Hey, fella," she said. Wagging his tail amiably, the dog came over. The woman in the wheelchair shot one of them a filthy look. Anna couldn't tell if it was aimed at her for some unknown reason or at the dog for consorting with her. The pooch sat and presented his ears for scratching. For a minute, Anna tended to the animal, waiting for a bit of the tension that had come with her and the two EMTs to drain out of the camp. The weather gods were not helping, as they did most every afternoon. Thunderheads had been building. Often, by nightfall, they'd dissipate. Not tonight. Lightning flickered to the southwest, startling the granite mountain peaks out of their sleep. Thunder rolled around as if auditioning for the roadshow of Rip Van Winkle. Anna could smell rain and taste the ozone on the back of her tongue. It was a night when, had she been a cat, she would have raced from room to room, leaping at shadows. The atmosphere was charged with a wildness as much metaphysical as meteorological. When the air felt less electric, without rising or leaving the dog, Anna addressed the older woman. "Dr. Littleton, can you tell me what happened?" The doctor rose, stepped into the light, and spread her hands as if she were about to give a formal oration. "My niece," she said. "This is my niece, Heath Jared. Anna Pigeon, district ranger." Anna introduced herself. Heath had gone for a walk. The word walk clanked against the metallic reality of the wheelchair, and the doctor came to a stop. "Which path did she take?" Anna asked, to get her over the rough patch. "Talk to me," the disabled woman demanded. She'd been growing more restive by the moment. Something had just reached critical mass. Anna could hear the ominous quiet of nuclear fission clicking behind her teeth. "What path did you take?" Anna repeated neutrally. It was too late. Ms. Jared had apparently reached a psychic point of no return. Despite the fact she had, nominally at least, gotten what she wanted, she pushed on. "People think a chair makes a person stupid or invisible or deaf. I can hear you. This is a wheelchair, not a fucking cone of silence." Anna laughed before she could stop herself. A laugh might not have endeared her to the woman, but it served to startle her out of her fit of pique. "So you went up the path. Which one?" Anna asked. Question by question, she got what she could of the story. It was short and simple. Ms. Jared wasn't inclined to be particularly helpful. The telling of the accident on the path and the discovery of the girls in their underwear was shortened to the point of haiku. "My chair, it tipped, fell. The girls were there in the woods. Aunt Gwen fixed their feet." The law enforcement officer in Anna was annoyed that any part of the girls that might contain trace evidence had been tampered with. The halfway decent human part of her was glad the children had been provided with some relief. During this staccato exchange, the girls grew not calmer precisely, but less demonstrative. Anna decided to see if they could be induced to trust themselves to her, the EMTs, the ambulance, the system. She stood, her knees cracking in protest. "Girls, Dr. Littleton, Miss Jared, what do you say we take a look at you, then get you a warm, safe place and call your folks?" The children shared a look, something hard and sharp. The tears continued. Anna turned from the light to one of the EMTs, Emily something, a seasonal who Anna had reason to know was 26, because wondering what an apparent 15-year-old was doing hanging around the backcountry's office computers, she'd asked. To Emily, she said, "It's them, isn't it?"
"It's them."
Emily looked to Ryan, who nodded. "It is," he confirmed. "We saw pictures. God, did we see pictures. Get me their names. Notify dispatch and Chief Knight. She'll want to call their folks. Tell dispatch we're going to need a child psychologist to meet us at the hospital. Tell them we'll roll as soon as we can get the kids into the ambulance." Anna started to turn back to the sad little party around the picnic table, but was stopped by Ryan's voice. "There were three of them." Three. Normally, even working in a park 1,000 miles away, she would have known this. But there'd been the wedding, and the decision, and the move. Slings and arrows she'd thought so earth-shaking. Now they seemed petty beyond belief. Three. In their earnestness, the rangers nodded like bobbleheads. "I need to know who we've got and who is still missing now," she added, when neither of them moved. "The little red-haired girl with the disabled woman is Beth Duane. She's 12. Her folks, all the girls, live near Loveland, an hour or so east of here," Emily said. Anna knew where Loveland, Colorado, was. She'd driven through it on her move to the park, rather than take the more traveled route from Denver through Boulder and into Estes Park. "The other one is older, 13. Her name is Alexis Shepherd. The one not here is Candace Watson. She's 13, too." "You sure?" Anna asked. Calling the girls by the wrong names could only further any sense they had of being forgotten or unsafe. Again the nods. Anna took them at their word. She knew from experience that the intensity of a prolonged search for missing children burned the victim's particulars into the brains of the would-be rescuers. Emily and Ryan would probably be able to rattle off this information with accuracy and in detail long after they'd forgotten their own names or the addresses of their nursing homes. Ryan, go on back to the ambulance, or out of earshot, and make the calls. Tell dispatch we're going to need search dogs come morning. See if we can backtrack to where the third girl is. Emily, come with me. Anna left her hat on the ground. It went against the grain. Her dog, Taco, a three-legged but brave-hearted lab, would have made short work of the Stetson as chew toy. Don't even think about it, she muttered to the helper dog, and walked back into the light. The blonde, Alexis Shepherd, looked the sturdier of the two, if one hummingbird in a hurricane can look stronger than another. Besides, she was in the sphere of Dr. Littleton, and, like the dog, the doctor seemed less likely to bite than the chair-bound Ms. Jared. Anna crossed slowly to the picnic table and eased herself onto the far end of the bench opposite the girl and the doctor. All the while, she talked softly. A lesson learned not from victim assistance training, but from working with horses in Guadalupe Mountains National Park early in her career. If she made noise or touched them when she walked behind them, they were less likely to startle and kick her. Hi, Alexis, she said. The girl flinched as if Anna had flicked her with a quirt rather than used a familiar form of address. We're so glad you and Beth are back. Everybody looked and looked, hundreds of people. You can't imagine how much your folks love you. Anna hoped this was true. Having not participated in the search, she was flying blind. But the details didn't matter. What mattered was that children hear right away and repeatedly that they might have been lost, but they'd never been forgotten, that their parents never quit hoping and looking. Even adults lost for long periods of time. Abandonment. In children of 12 and 13, too young for adult rationale, too old for childish faith, these feelings could be cripplingly acute. Half turning to include Beth in the conversation, Anna noticed the littler girl had started sucking her thumb. Ryan, he's one of the rangers who came to help us take you to your families, has gone to call them so they can meet us at the hospital. This here is Emily. She's a ranger, too. If you'll let her, she'd like to check real quick and see if you're hurt. Then we'll get you out of here. How does that sound? Anna thought she'd made the whole thing sound pretty doggone spiffy, but both girls hung their heads. Literally let them hang from the very top vertebrae till their noses pointed at their navels. The tears fell unimpeded onto the fronts of the borrowed running suits. The Jared woman held the one girl in her arms like a bundle of laundry. She must be a good deal stronger than she looked, Anna thought. The kid would weigh close to 80 pounds. Dark thoughts crowded in. These kids didn't seem thrilled to be back, just relieved to be gone from where they'd been. They didn't cry for Mama and Daddy. The promise of home didn't bring on renewed energy or hope, but an increase in anxiety. Maybe they hadn't been lost. This kettle of worms had been thoroughly looked into long before Anna came to Rocky. The possibilities were runaways, stranger abduction, accidental death, or abduction by a family member. The lack of enthusiasm Beth and Alexis showed when the words parents and home were bandied about suggested either runaways or possible abduction by a family member. Anna let it go for the moment. The first order of business was to get them to a medical facility. Moving emotionally damaged children was not something she'd done much. Did one drag them shrieking to the ambulance and lock them in? Force them into the cage in the patrol car at gunpoint? They needed psychiatric care. They needed nurses, mommies, the kind of sucker she couldn't even begin to offer. They needed to be moved the hell out of her park. Have they spoken at all? She asked Dr. Littleton. One of them said something to Heath, I think, when she found them, before I got there. Anna turned to Heath Jared. The little limpet, Beth, said it's a dog. She meant Wiley, not me. Anything else? The woman's face lost its angry look as she sent her mind back 20 minutes and 2,000 heartbeats. Anna was startled at the difference it made. She'd put her age at about that of her own, but Jared was probably 10 years younger. Very pretty in an Edith Piaf, Gigi, Apache dancer sort of way. Fine and exotic. And volatile. High maintenance, Anna thought. Beth said Humpty Dumpty. Me, not the dog, because I'd taken a great fall, I suppose. Skip, Alexis, said she thought I was a bear. I don't think they've spoken since. To the child in her lap, she said, "You don't have to talk to you want."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.